Hello people, it's Billy here from the SWN podcast. Before this episode begins with Casino Brutale, I've got to give you a little bit of a warning. So before we did the recording in my kitchen, it was done via phone, which is what I'm doing on this bit right now. And I thought it was going to save like it did with the Jan and Stan episode, where like I pop up on screen and then when Casino Brutale speak, they pop up on screen and it just goes back and forth like that. So I make some comments to it, maybe some jokes towards it as well. And there's also a joke at the end about it. But it makes no sense because when you go watch the episode, it's saved as a gallery view. So I'm on one side, Casino Brutale on the other. And now it just looks silly. So just giving you that warning for the video episode. But otherwise, this is an amazing chat. Enjoy it. It was great. It's Casino Brutale. Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host as always, Billy. I apologise for the sound and vision at my end here because I'm recording, as you can see in the background, in my kitchen. So I'm very aware this episode will be like the one with Jan the Slavic one, where when I speak, I'm on full screen like a jump scare. And then when my guests speak, they'll also appear on the screen like a jump scare. I am joined on this episode, if you haven't read the title already, by one of the most underrated teams in Scotland right now, and they're quickly becoming to the forefront of Scottish wrestling.
That's guy.
Returning guests, Rabu Romero and Mikey Devine. It is Casino Brutale. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Hey,
man. Thanks for having us.
So I was.
You may regret that shortly, but.
You know. I might be good that we've got this weird kind of screen thing going where I could just. Like go in the corner and just regret all my life choices while you guys are just
It's a handicap match, so I'm lucky for you, man. Yeah,
I'm sorry. I was laughing to Kelly saying that when you come on the screen, it's just going to be we're just three bald blokes speaking.
Yep,
that can be the podcast in itself, to be honest. Just three eggs on a thumbnail. Yeah. So last time we spoke, it was November 2021 for Mikey, December 2021 for Rabu. It was actually, I think it was November because they came out like. Either side of the month, so it's been a while. There's been a pandemic. The pandemic has lifted just about at that point. I think did we have Christmas that year? I can't remember if we were allowed to see our loved ones.
That's weird because that would have been literally we've only had maybe like one match, really? Two matches as Casino Brutale at that point.
No, we only had one, two.
Oh, it was one or two.
No.
It was one or two. Yeah, because we had... because we had first ever community pro wrestling show. That was the first time we were ever Casino Brutale. Mm-hmm. Rather than Smashing Brothers. And then we had...
Lou and Krieger.
But if it was recording November, that was December, wasn't it? Because it was after Fear and Loathing. It was right at the end of the year, wasn't it? Do you remember, Billy? Had we only had one match as Casino Brutale when we talked to you?
Well, I have written down ICW debut December 2021 versus the Ronin. So that was the match after our chat. So it would have been already recorded at that point.
We'd have literally had one chat, as Casino Brutale. Mikey's going to do some calculations. And we'll see what you have down, Billy.
I've just got one little pad of paper because I'm working against technology today. But this is going to bode well for the episode.
He's away.
Sorry. I was going to say, it's going to bode well for the episode that you guys are arguing about the exact same point.
What a tag team.
We've got loads of questions in through Instagram, which I'll attempt to ask as I go through. Looks like I've written them down. So I'm working against, again, not only technology, but my own handwriting. It always starts off really well and then just goes into absolute shit. I didn't actually say, last time we spoke, I think I had like rules against swearing. They are all gone now. So you can say whatever you want within reason.
Any swear words at all?
Well, this is going to spoil folk. Actually, I won't because the episode will be out. But I've just done the road trip episode to WrestleZone and we put a bit with Ronan King. And I had 90 seconds and he called wrestling fans cunts twice.
Nice.
So, you know.
What a man. What a boy. So, what a title. He's some guy.
So that's the.
That's the level we're at now. I've given up stopping people swearing because I don't want to edit it out either. Anyway, so as Mikey's shit cage match and confirmed how many matches I've had this cage match.
I've right, every match I have, whether it's he's singles or I'm singles, I write it down on my phone in my notes.
Do you write down my matches as well?
Because I get the singles matches and I don't need it.
That's fair. That's fair.
36 matches since we last spoke as Casino Brutale. That's taken out singles matches.
Not bad. So I think cage match maybe all are missing a couple then. It's probably ones that I haven't been able to find because I think they just steal info from us. To be honest. The bastards. Anyway, this is derailed very quickly already. So 36, we've confirmed 100%, 36 matches as Casino Brutale since we last chatted. That's one fact done.
I'm counting every match since.
But we've only had one when we talked to him because we talked to him in November.
Like, I'm counting after ICW, right?
Right, so about 8.
36.
Right, so, Billy, do your stuff, sorry.
Okay. Well, the first question is usually just how's it going, guys? But it feels like you're going to have a little bit of a meltdown.
We agree on everything, you know, everything's smooth, you know, we never have any disagreements. What a fucking thing.
There's no swearing, but I like to swear. I say whatever you want about him. Ronan King called wrestling fans cunts twice in the space of 90 seconds. What a fucking lad, eh?
We'd only met him recently. He was brand new, man. What a guy.
Yeah. He really is until you put a camera on him and he just turns into the biggest bastard you've ever met. anyway, right.
Yeah, pretty good, man. Pretty good. We just had a solid weekend of wrestling there. So we had Blockbuster, we had ICW, so things are really picking up for us.
It is, and it's really great to see tag team wrestling really pick up this year, especially. I don't know if it's just a lot of teams are now really realizing that it's not just the wrestling side of things. It's also you got to be a package deal kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So things like promos, which we'll definitely get into, and gear, which we'll get into as well. So it's actually you've got to be a team now to be booked as a team because there's that many decent tag teams in the country as well. So for you guys, of course, that is picking up because you're, I mean, quote-unquote, a decent tag team. So since the return and you've had your 36 to 38 matches, how have you kind of approached tag team wrestling since the return, since the shows came back? Was that more of a, you had one match as the Smashing Brothers, Casino Brutale, and then since the shows came back, was it just all in on tag team, just making sure that it's the best it can possibly be, Casino Brutale?
Well, I think it was what, like, obviously we repackaged ourselves. When we were Smashing Brothers, we did have the matching gear, which was the red and black, typical bad guy colours. When it was Casino Brutale, we just tried to make sure we were, as Rab wanted to put it, like, levelling up on everything. So, not just our matches, but like, the ring gear needed to change and be more out there. Just be completely stand out, be completely different from every other team, which we do try and do.
It's hard for two bald guys with beards to really stand out sometimes, even just from like a glancing visual, like casual fan type of like, oh, who are these guys or whatever. It's like Mikey said, you know, kind of leveling up everything. Like, we also specifically picked our theme music. We changed our gear to be a lot more kind of in tune with like our characters and stuff. We've kind of found our dynamic of even like moves wise and stuff. We tried to kind of do kind of separation of concerns. So Mikey does more like ground based kind of amateur, you know, like suplexes, throws, etc. I'll try and do more like strikes and aerial work just to, because we get the feedback quite a few times that we look very similar. And people still regularly will go like that to us. Well, one is, oh, see, in that match, you did such and such, that was great. And I'll be like, oh, no, that was the other one. Even though we've got, you know, one of us wears a singlet and one of us wears tights now. But, yeah, man, just our whole approach, I guess, has just been to try and find every facet that we can and, you know, make it as different as possible. And also the promos are really like that. That seems to be our niche, to really stand out from people. None of that standing in front of a brick wall stuff, you know.
The thing I had a pet peeve recently on our episode I talked about is promos in cars. When did that become a thing?
It's just a bit lazy, man, isn't it? Like, I can understand, let's say if a promoter kind of goes to you like, oh, like I need a promo at the very last minute and you don't have any time to prepare, and but just get your car at least, man, and like, you know, either that is find a brick wall. You know, don't do it with your dash cam. It's not Road Wars. I'm not a fan of that one either.
Promos and cars.
I spend a lot of time
on. Yeah, you're going to want to do promos on there as well.
I feel like you're really silent back there because you just thought, oh shit, I've recorded like 3 promos in my car for other shows.
I think of one I could do in my car now.
will we do a car promo but make it ridiculous? Do it in the DeLorean from Back to the Future, I think.
Dodgers.
We've got the Comic Con coming up. Perfect.
Oh, we've already got something down for Comic Con, man. Don't you worry. I think you'll enjoy it.
I was recording the episode for it that's going to come out. I don't know why I'm saying it's going to come out. It's already out at this point. But I did it in my car, just the opening bit for the road trips. And I thought it'd be really clever. I got this tripod on, set it up. And then about 10 minutes in, it fell. And it fell just pretty much down between my legs. And I had to go try and find it while I was still driving. And I thought, this is not the safest recording environment I've ever done. Acoustics were great, though. So got to, maybe that's why people are doing it in cars. We do have a question about the promos, though, from Westy.
Of course.
And watch me try to read this.
Love you, Westy.
Love you, Westy.
Although, man, she's so good. She's like a fucking revolver ocelot. The speed she goes at, it's crazy.
She
takes every show. It's ridiculous.
Because I've got to pester her for results most of the time, because if I need the results down in Glasgow, it's Westy that I go to. That's just the easiest thing to do. Okay. And she's got them noted segments, noted everything. I'll just take the results because I don't know what happened in the segment. I can't put a segment. But she's just ace. Absolute athlete. I think the fight would be absolutely dead without her most of the time. Anyway, she's asked. Oh, God, my writing. You hit it out of the park with promos. How do you come up with the ideas? And what's been your favourite ones to do so far?
He comes up with all the promo ideas.
I don't come up with all of them.
Yeah.
I'm quite good at coming up with a concept. We'll usually try and make them thematic around, you know, cool, what kind of different way can we approach this particular match? And what can we make that either would be... sometimes it's just, you know, it would be funny if we did a promo like this. And then I'll actually sit in bed and I'll think and I'll go, oh, wait, no, that's a narrative we can do. We can actually do it. That's not so ridiculous. We can actually do that promo. And then I'll take it to Mikey. And Mikey's usually very good at finding his spot within it that will actually make it entertaining while I just do the talking kind of thing. So,
for example, not as much a promo, but an idea that was Rab's idea. Builders last year, I think you had seen it, but Rab could make a show. So I took the mannequin instead. That was his idea to do that, and I just kind of took the ball and ran with it.
It was more of a throwaway comment or something, you could realistically do that because there was a mannequin in the asylum, but how Mikey put all the garnish and stuff on it and all the little affectations and everything, ridiculous, incredible, you know. So I guess that's the way that the promos normally kind of evolve.
My personal favourite promo,
I think the Doctor promo is my favourite. The
Doctor promo was great.
Do you see the Doctor promo? The one for CPW?
I think so. I'm trying, because there's the one that's coming into my head is the horse. The horse seems to be coming in quite a lot. And I'm thinking of some of your best ones, but I'm going to have to go back because you hit, like Westy's saying, you do hit it out of the park every time. Was probably one of it. As soon as you guys...
The horse one was actually just a complete fill enough. It was to do with the brick wall promos. It was somebody put up a comment about boring brick wall promos, and Mikey went, I've got a horse. I'm gonna go and do a promo on my horse. and then sent me it like 6 hours later, just finished, just oh yeah. Because was that not the one for Hatching? And that's it.
For Hatching, which had the mannequin.
Yeah.
And then
because that was what was that then?
Then I done another promo on Jerry the horse.
Jerry the horse.
One day after work, it was on the lead up to Gudders versus FPWA, and Frank Gallo's promos are always really good. He's a very
what a guy,
wild character. That kind of, I was like, is he trying to be weirder than me?
Yeah, Mikey took this as like an actual challenge. Like, who the fuck does this guy think he is? I'm the weird guy in Scottish wrestling.
How dare he? So that's how the second promo on the horse came about.
He is class though. I love Frank Gallo. Such a good guy, man. That FPW match. That, in fact, that's a pure sleeper one because that was a really good one. I really enjoyed that match. We had it was us and Leon Graves, RIP, versus the Pa and Frank Gallo. I don't think it really got that much coverage because it was part of the kind of 2 day thing. But no, that was sick.
That was a good match.
But best promo wise, I think because we've all, like, if you look back at them over the course of like how long, what was probably the first ridiculous one that we did?
First ridiculous promo.
There's been quite a few now, ain't there? I'll cycle through the Instagram feed.
My personal favourite, anyway, is the four corner tag match at Gudders.
Oh, yeah.
Where we were given odds and we were doing the pros and cons for each tag team. So it was us, Kevin, the young team, and Arcade Violence. And it was just like the bits of paper getting pulled off, and it was just like, listen, that's probably my personal, but I think that's probably.
Yeah, so
that's probably because that's. It was the one where I took the majority part of talking, and that's probably why that's my favourite.
Yeah, no, you did very well. The very first ridiculous one we did was for Deadpool Danger, where we did the spinning wheel.
Deadpool Danger, yes.
Yeah, that was because you look at how we put that together, and it's not as polished, it's not quite as good. And then, you know, you kind of go through them, and then it's the production values going up, trying to do some more stuff like on location or bringing in a green screen, etc. Kat obviously really helps with this. Like, she's absolutely incredible. She does all the kind of editing and stuff. Like, how good. We're just a bunch of idiots that she makes look good. So, but yeah, no, I think the fortune teller one was pretty sick as well.
Yeah, fortune teller one was good.
CBNN. Yeah, sorry, no, the newest one. The newest one's the best one we've done. That is the best one we've done, just objectively.
Because we
managed to cut so much together, going to you being on the street, the stuff that we'd done in the house, like, yeah, no, that was...
As well, there's across from NQ64 in Glasgow, there is a restaurant that has, like, a big table that can do, like, can sit a lot of people. And while we were filming my part of CBNN promo, outside NQ64, that table was full, and I was standing with a suit jacket, a tearaway shirt, a tie, and my knee gear. I was in my knee pads and boots, and so it wasn't as if I was just in, like, normal. It was the full lot, like, and then having to rip that off while these people are staring over, it was a bit...
And then do your yee-haw and stuff, yeah, no, that was so good, man. They're literally applauding for the
They were applauding, giving thumbs up and that, and I was like,
absolute tripper, man. This also gives, I guess, us just more of a vehicle as well to like show the distinction between our character that normally like, you're not so much the butt of the joke as just you're the more like outgoing one, and you are I'd say definitely more charismatic than I am. So maybe I can anchor it, and then you know, it's just. Mikey's never done wanting to go like, oh, what if I dress up as this? What if I do that? He wanted to be a baby in the doctor promo, but we couldn't get the filter to work. So but yeah.
So
promos, yeah, that's so I would say I think our best one, yeah, is CBNN.
CBNN. And of course
I was gonna say to throw out a comparison, last time I spoke to you both I kept saying FTR because you know, bald. But that kind of dynamic is very much like a Hart Foundation, isn't it? You have Rabu being the Bret Hart, does the words, the eloquent talking, and then you've got Mikey as Neidhart, just a bit nuts in the background, stroking his chin and just going kind of thing.
I'll take being very good. Thank you very much.
There you go. That's your Halloween promo idea. Just get the greasy wig and just big and black.
That's true. Well, we didn't even get a dress. We were meant to be in a costume battle royal last year, and then it didn't happen. We were going to be a hot dog and a hamburger.
Right.
But I got my mouth burst open in the match right before it, so I didn't have time to get my hot dog on. Raging.
What a phrase to
go out. Didn't get to get my hot dog on. Yeah, there you go, Westy. I hope that was a sufficiently entertaining answer for you, even if it did last about 20 minutes. So
that's fine. It'll be most of the time, like I said, because this whole technical thing, it'll just be people looking at your faces for 20 minutes. So that's not always a bad thing when I'm looking like death at this end. But that actually brings us on to Deep Pool Danger, which is perfect. Because this is, like you're saying, that was one of your first ones, the proper Casino Brutale experience for people. Was Deadpool Danger. We spoke to Arcade Violence about it, an episode that will be out by now. And they weren't totally complimentary with the result, of course, because AC Anderson became Brody Turnbull. But the concept of Deadpool Danger,
better name, so I don't know why this guy's got beef with
it. He should be thanking me.
Yeah. And also watch for the sunset flip.
Exactly.
You fucking loser. God. And then maybe you won't have to change your name. How is this our fault?
So Deadpool Danger, though. Who's, how, why? That's all the three questions about it. Whose idea? How did you approach it? And why did Deadpool Danger become a thing?
Legitimately, it was actually Brody/AC/Scott's idea, because he wanted to change his name. He'd had some issues, I think, because it sounded too similar to like CW Anderson, who was in ECW, or like Ace Anderson, even being in Scotland or whatever. And he came up with the idea and came to us and basically went, I'd like to like gamble my name away to you. How can we kind of make that happen? And then we also came up with the spinning wheel idea. It was great. That's probably one of our favourite matches we've ever had.
That's my favourite match this year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fun enough, the first time that ever faced Arcade Violence. And at the time, it felt like, God, we've never wrestled Arcade Violence. Sandra. And now we fucking can't move 2 feet without bumping into Arcade Violence. So.
But I think that's the one that, like I say, it's your first one. So that's the one that people started properly. Well, for me anyway, it was the first time I saw the promo. I was like, oh my God, why have I been not paying attention to these guys? Because that's incredible. Just the concept itself. But the fact that it was just the whole promo for it as well, that it was taken so seriously but not serious at the same time, and it just that really got to show people that aren't in the area, that aren't going to CPW or Iron Girders or can't go to these shows, that you guys are fully three-dimensional characters, not just two bald blokes with beards doing some wrestling.
Exactly, man. Exactly.
Did you get any other feedback from people just specifically about that? Have you been thinking, have you been looking at other wrestlers going, God, your name's a bit shite. Let's, would you like to
do that? The thing that popped me, but also I was a little bit like, all right, cheers, guys. When we put up a poll before it saying, like, whose name do you think was going to get changed? And I think pretty much everybody voted for me. And I was like, what's fucking wrong with my name? Fuck! Come on, guys. Sabu, right? Come on, maybe no. Yeah, but no, it was nice. I think when the response that we got from that video, I think, is when we were like, "Wait, this is what we should be doing." And I guess the way that we try and think about it a lot of the time is it's kind of like DX or Kurt Angle, where we can have a laugh and a joke, we can do these kind of parodies and stuff, but ultimately, like, it doesn't necessarily reflect on our ring style. We can do some comedy stuff, but generally when we do our matches, like, whether we're face or heel as well, we'll fucking go. Basically, you know, it's not just going to be
just all comedy.
Yeah. So it's just finding that mix, I guess. So, but that seems to be what's worked for us. I don't think we've had a promo yet where people have had anything less than complimentary to say about it, to be honest.
You've delicately slipped past the question of any of the wrestlers with shite names that you want to change.
Oh, people with shite names. Oof. Are we shooting here? Are we shooting here, Billy? Okay.
Yes.
Who's got a shite name? What do you mean you don't know?
I don't know.
Let's see who's got a shite name. There must be somebody. Nobody jumps in. Come on. You usually get something less on hand.
What are you trying to say? What are you trying to say?
So, everybody voted for me. You know what I mean? So apparently
I'll throw one out there because I can't say their name. Koshium Kilmurray. He could kill the big lad. Just because I can't.
No.
Difficult to spell and say.
Not the most marketable.
No, yeah. And you mentioned Hashi as well. I'll throw him in there. I'm just throwing the girders guys because they've got really complicated names. And when I was doing like wrestle scene each week and at 10 o'clock in the morning, trying to read names, going, how do I say that one? And I gave up eventually. I got really, really like, and with that as well, there's other podcasts I listen to, not just this one. People should not listen to any others and just listen to this one anyway. But there was one I was doing disco reviews and they butchered every name, and I was like really concentrating really hard to get make sure Koshium's, I'm assuming that's his name, correct.
Koshium.
And then I'm listening to this podcast, this other podcast, and they're calling I like that Immersion Jane, and and like butchered every name, and I'm like, why am I bothering? Nope. This is the level where I can just call them anything now. It's fine. So yeah, that's just. I'm just going into my own shoots here. So yeah,
there's one person with a terrible name that I can think of, but I think he's actually changed it. I think he now goes by Gaz Williams, but he did go by Gash Williams.
Yes.
Lovely guy, man. Lovely guy, but Gash, like, that's just an unfortunate. Like, people are just gonna, you know.
Yeah.
So, Gaz, yeah, I think that works a lot better.
Yes, yeah, that's absolutely. I interviewed him when he was Gash, but there we go.
He has changed it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. He's definitely Gaz. Right.
There you go. That's good.
Yeah. So yeah, Gash is not great for, especially Scotland in general. But
Exactly.
So anyway, moving on. Let's not just call every wrestler having shite names. We'll go into more questions we've got here. We haven't really spoke about your last year or last time you really wrestled, because we've got confusion
about how many matches you had. 2 years, basically, now, I guess.
Pretty much, yeah. And I was looking through the people that you wrestled. It's mostly Arcade Violence, Govan Team, Young KOE. Team, KOE, and then that kind of just... like go around in circles from there a little bit.
We have wrestled these gentlemen quite a few times at this point, yeah. But you know, freshen up. You know, we had BT and Kez yesterday, so that was a new experience. So that was cool. Not that we don't. To be fair, love wrestling KOE, love wrestling Arcade.
Love wrestling Young Team.
Well, I guess we've only done the Young Team once, haven't we? So we've yet to be.
If you include.
I wouldn't really include the Fatal 4-Way, I guess. I'm talking maybe kind of 2-on-2.
I did the 3-way.
But even then, it wasn't really a tag match.
No.
It's totally
wrestling.
Yeah, 2-on-2, we've only ever faced the Young Team twice, so we've yet to be locked into a we're going to be doing this forever thing with them as well. And obviously the Govan Team, those were wrestling every other week, but... not really. In fact, well, how many different versions of the Govan Team have we wrestled? I think we've wrestled all iterations of them.
We've completed that.
We've wrestled Xander and Ravy and Steg. Steg and Xander, all three of them at the same time. Wrestled Archie Williams. He was an honorary Govan Team member for one night. We've wrestled several thousand variations. It's like the multiverse of the Govan Team, yeah. The governess or whatever. So
with that, did you find it? Again, it was another question I spoke to Arcade Violence about, because they came in as a team, and that's pretty much how their modus operandi is now. But do you find that the wrestling tag teams is just that guys are actual teams is a lot easier than just two singles wrestlers? Do you find that's a little bit more of a smoother night for you, or do you just approach it kind of the same way?
It kind of depends because I guess we've not faced that many individual guys. I think maybe three or
I'll put a match out there that was two singles wrestlers we wrestled, and the match actually went very well. It was the Wanderer and Jan. They two are singles wrestlers,
the Slavic Wanderers.
and we wrestled them for CPW, and the match did go really well, and I did actually really enjoy the match.
Yeah, Dal Mellington. Yeah, that was a good laugh.
No.
So
Yeah,
that kind of
yes,
nice.
it's like it is a kind of different dynamic because also like, especially if it's like I don't know how long the Wanderer's been wrestling. Jan's not been wrestling as long as we have. Particularly in that kind of case, we were having to kind of go like, cool, well maybe you'd want to fill in this space with maybe like a wee tag move and kind of get the crowd going and blah 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 and show out, etc. And we had to kind of like maybe suggest tag moves or kind of spots or something they would do. Whereas obviously if you come up against the more established team, they've already got the stuff. And then it's more just finding where their spots fit in match wise rather than having to kind of reinvent the wheel, I guess. So
No.
but we've not really been up against any, I think we've only had like three or four matches that have been against two singles guys. Because we had like Levi and Martin McAllister. We had Martin McAllister and Seg. We had
Levi.
them again at Comic Con.
Levi
Levi and
and Mark.
Martin McAllister,
Levi and Luke.
Oh, I had Levi and Luke.
That was
Yeah,
another. That
Wood
was another.
Street, I
That was
forgot about
another. That was
that.
another great match
That
up
was another fun match, yeah.
against two singles wrestlers.
But yeah, we've yet to come up against like generally the guys who even have been teaming together have usually been pretty good friends anyway. It's not like we've been put on a show and they've just had to pull two completely random people together who don't gel. So we've never really had
No,
any major issues
we've
that
not.
way.
We've never.
But it is a lot easier if you're facing an actual tag team who obviously know their stuff
Yep.
from A to Z. Another
Absolutely.
very long answer. Apologies.
That's absolutely fine. It's making my one page of notes kind of get buffed out a little bit, so that's all good. So
What can I say? Making a lot of
you spoke about community pro wrestling, which I always ask about this because the shows I've seen usually it's the government ones they put up online, and you guys seem to be having a lot of fun when you go to the community pro shows because the crowd's just up for everything,
a
and
little.
they'll pretty much tell you if they don't enjoy what they're watching at the same time. How have you found the crowds at CPW specifically? Just I don't know how Ravy Davies done it. I was about to just call him first name Ravy. Ravy Davies done it, but he seems to have taken the Govan crowd and like transported it around the country. So how
To
do
be
you because
fair, man, he's pretty smart with his booking because Ravi will usually put two or three guys from the local area on a show to obviously kind of draw in like wrestling fans from there because they'll know these guys as well as it being like the attraction of, and they'll still get the thing of like it's a relatively new promotion, so like it's still got that kind of ooh like new factor and stuff, especially if he's going to different places, but also like they put in a lot of work for like Raving people will drive to wherever it is and do a lot of like
Oh,
flyering, putting up posters, talking to people, doing a lot of kissing babies, shaking hands, etc. And no, fair play to him, no, he just does it very well, to be fair. I'm like obviously like a lot of people have a lot of different opinions about Ravi, but can't really fault him in terms of how he's been, putting his shows together
yeah.
and getting a crowd in, etc., which is obviously ultimately, you can complain about, booking or whatever, but the guy's selling out like every show that he does, so he must be, he's putting asses in seats. So
I'm still a bit gutted that you guys weren't the mystery team in Peterhead, but
so are we.
felt so bad, Mikey had seen that comment. I'm like, oh no, man! Like, there's nothing we can do. But that's a shame. I'm sure we'll be up your neck of the woods.
I mean, I still enjoyed it. It was still a good show, but yeah, as soon as the music hit, I was like, I don't think that's them guys in all the pack came out. It's definitely them. That's way too much hair to be.
That's a lot of hair.
But no, that's right. He's doing. You've got Santi Morella coming. He's got Eric Young coming as well. So I'm assuming you guys have already tried to maybe approach some, get some hot hockey sticks out. We can go and Davey, I've got an idea for a promo with some hockey sticks. Give me Eric Young.
That's a good idea.
That's a good idea.
I might have to talk to him about Eric Young. See if we can do a Cobra promo or something as well. Get involved with Santino. try Cobra. Fair play, man. Even the title tournament stuff they put on. So like we got Grado on that show, which was pretty fantastic. But the money that he'd obviously basically, I guess at that point, kind of gambled on, because that was the first kind of more adult show, I guess, he'd done, because it was more, instead of just being like, oh, family friendly lesson, it was like, no, we're establishing this title, going to bring in these bigger names like Simon Maller and Derice and, all these kind of guys. And especially over 2 days, like, he couldn't have really known how successful it would be. Mm-hmm. But, again, it was like two sellouts. Even, Thatch won the title or whatever, but, the crowd absolutely, stunned silence, so,
mm-hmm.
it did the job. So yeah, can't really fault him. He's taking these gambles, but they seem to be calculated in such a way that it pays off. So maybe Ravi should get a gambling gimmick actually. Maybe we're old hat. We'll just do funny promos, just drop the gambling stuff entirely.
I mean, you speak about Thatcher there. I mean, did you forgive you at some point in Community Pro? You were kind of Tories adjacent because you were with Thatcher's cabinet. Were you very keen not to try and go down the Tory trope?
Not really. We had
one or two matches alongside them. I did do the pose.
It was usually like we were like hired hooligans rather than being like, because mm-hmm. he's got like big Chez and all those guys who are like, turn up in the suits and do all the kind of the actual kind of Tory-ish stuff, when it was more like we were just a couple of other bad guys who could easily be paid to cause trouble kind of thing.
Right.
Like in the Govan gang fight and all that stuff. So that was a good laugh actually, since we got to work Arthur. So that was good before he went off to Japan.
Yeah.
So that was
but, yeah, you mentioned that you were kind of the, it's almost like in the best possible way that if there's a villain that needs to pop in, you guys turn up, the crowd kind of goes, ah, oh, nay them, but in a good way, because they're like, oh, they know what
this is the weird thing, man. We worked face in CPW for the first time the other week, and the crowd fucking loved us. So I think they've obviously enjoyed our antics, and at the time when we're healing it up, they're like, oh, these fucking guys, but we're really ready, to uh-huh. we had LND, another really fun match, great guys to work.
Definitely.
Big Fulton and wee Sammy. But like when we went out, we were like, all right, cool, we're gonna have to cut a promo, and we're gonna have to, because they've come in as heel. We're gonna have to like cut a promo and kind of get this idea across to make sure the crowd will actually come up for us. But they were already cheering before we'd even done the promo. And then when I hit Sammy in the head with the microphone, it just sealed the deal, So no, it was they seemed ready to love our shenanigans as well. But yeah, it was weird to get cheered at CPW.
I don't think you'll ever hear a Euro bad guys chant.
Yeah, that was the thing, yeah.
So I didn't catch that. You're very quiet in the background. What was the chant?
You're our bad guys.
Yeah, we did the promo where I basically went like, oh, they're bad guys, we're bad guys. The difference is we're your bad guys, bop. And then Mikey kicked Fulton in the balls. So good times. Not so much for Fulton or his reproductive chances, but yeah.
So it's kind of like, I'm throwing you all the compliments here, calling you the Heart Foundation, but a bit like an Eddie Guerrero, Los Guerreros kind of thing. It's like, yeah, we'll do the cheating things, but we're doing it for you guys to entertain, kind of thing.
We did initially have that, because we worked heel for what?
So long.
I guess it felt like so long, because the first time we ever worked face was filling off Comic-Con last year, and we literally worked heel one day, then face the next. And it was strange to kind of try and find that level of Because at first, you know, we're kind of, all right, cool, we've got to be babyface, so we're doing the clapping, we're doing the whatever, and blah, 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 and it's all a bit white meat and a bit shit.
I absolutely loved it. I absolutely loved it.
But then finding more like our level of not full face, because I don't think that necessarily absolutely works. Just, it works better for you. It doesn't really work for me to be like super, super facey. So I guess Mikey being like Kia, and then me being here, and then that being like the heel face line is probably that.
I waited so long.
Come on, guys!
Come out and give it the ultimate one, guys. Aye, exactly.
Come on, guys. Cheers, Arthur. Just that.
That was good.
He's stomping the mat going, we need support, yeah, and all that, just all of it, all the tropes.
Shake the barrier, I love it.
Your fancy jacket take off and all that, man. Yeah.
So you're enjoying being good guys then? Well, yeah, man, one of you are.
It's the weirdest thing that we seem to be a lot better at. I guess we can still be heel, but we seem to have really found our niche being baby faces and doing these stupid DX promos and kind of, it was just funny because I don't think we ever really even worked face in training for a long, long time either.
No.
And then it was only, yeah. So yeah, it was felt very unfamiliar at first, but now it's, you know, basically everywhere we go, we're face, pretty much apart. Yeah, it was even in ICW, we weren't expecting, we'd done like some enhancement matches being heels. And then we get brought in and did the whole thing with KOE where they attacked us, and then suddenly we were baby faces there, baby faces in Gutters. We've done baby face in CPW. Like, yeah.
That's just baby face.
Yeah, really. Fucking classic blue eye baby faces here. Probably. Him more than me too. You're a good baby face. I'm more of a just taking down the level of bastard there, whatever, you know, just, yeah.
I was going to say, and no offense to you, but you do have a kind of face of that goes, did you? Kind of thing, did you?
Yeah, no, I've heard that before. Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. Whereas Mikey's super lovable, and then I'm like just the anchor that kind of keeps him from going absolutely fucking insane. So some of your mad spots that you want to do, man, honestly. He tried to get Bezos Edge for a table in Johnston for no reason. Well, like, why'd you put me through the table? No, what's wrong with you? Just, yeah. What do you like? Mikey would have had a much shorter career already had, you know, if I wasn't the brakes on his fucking runaway train.
Well, speaking of that, has there been any like promos or you mentioned those little spots there, but has there been any promo ideas that has been approached where you just went, no, just flat out, no?
Don't think we've had any. Because usually it's, I'll come up with an idea and a concept and I'll think, oh, this is a bit silly, and then you'll come up with an even sillier idea to do for you.
Yeah.
But that's usually just the way, Mikey usually escalates it, if anything, rather than it
being... And then you put the roof on it, you just cap it, good. That's plenty.
I don't hate that, man. A lot of the time, when it comes to matches, yeah, I have to put a roof on it for his literal safety because he's a psychopath. But when it comes to promos, like, well, actually, there have been a couple of times I've had to put a riff on it. Like when you wanted to do, you wanted to do the thing from Shrek. You wanted to do the three, pick number three, my lord thing. And I was like, Mikey, you're not that stupid. Like, that's not wrong. Like, you're just trying to pop yourself now. You're just wanting to make pop culture references that, like, aren't actually indicative of the characters that we are. Pick number three, my lord. I think it was one of the early ones you wanted to do it. I can't remember, man. There's been a few now, but I think it was definitely one of the early ones. You wanted to be like really, really dumb, and it was like you're not at, like, that's not.
There was a couple of bits and problems as well. See the four corners tag match one. See how changing glasses, different sets of glasses on. I go for sunglasses to normal glasses. I wanted see the googly ones. I wanted them. I wanted the glasses with the fake mustache as well. The glasses, nose, and mustache.
Are they from Mr. Potato Head?
There have been a couple of occasions where maybe Mikey has went, let's do this, and I've been like, right, that's maybe let's just take the edge off it a wee bit, you know, let's not go absolutely, you know, because again, it's trying to find that line of being funny, but still being able to be taken at least mildly seriously, yeah. Because anyway, it's still a wrestling promo or whatever, but yeah.
But I think that plays into advantage. We've spent more time speaking about promos than we have actual wrestling. But I think it plays into advantage because it only gets across to you as a character, but it advertises the show at the same time. That's why I was saying Eric, get hockey sticks, Eric Young, get some of the Cobra Santino, because if you're one of the only guys on the show that are putting out high quality promos, then people are going to go, oh, that's a high quality content. I better go to that show itself. So it all works in your favour in the end.
Part of it, man, just trying to stand out. Mm-hmm. And this has been the thing ultimately that's made us stand out. And it's kind of almost been twofold, where we've gotten more opportunities to wrestle longer matches or better matches or bigger matches because our promos have put more eyes on us. And then we've been able to show that, oh, we're actually quite good at this wrestling part as well. Whereas necessarily might not have got those opportunities before, kind of thing. So, yeah.
Right. Let's go back to the questions then, because I've still got loads in here. So, right. We'll go. Lily McLeod should ask two quite nice questions. So we'll go with that. Lily McLeod asked, "Fave place you've ever wrestled."
Also, hi, Lily. Lily takes a lot of pictures and stuff. Or is it CBW? Good, Lily. Yeah. Favorite place to wrestle, promotion-wise, or physical location, or
well, that's the question that was asked, so you can interpret it how you want.
My favorite promotion to wrestle for is Gumpers. My favorite venue to wrestle for.
So I think Garda's is my favourite promotion for us to wrestle for, because, you know, like, Garda's built and everyone, like, we are, that is our bread and butter. Mm-hmm. Garda's is, you know, without Iron Garda's, we'd be nothing. Yeah. So we can never repay that particular debt, you know. So, like, but even just the crowds and stuff, like, it's usually like a great mix of like families and adults and stuff. People are really into it. The shows in general are just, you know, pretty top quality from top to bottom. Always love a Garda show. I think physical place, though, I think getting to wrestle in the garage on Shugs was pretty special, because that was like, obviously, like, I don't know so much about you, Mikey. Like, what, in fact, well, how many shows would you have gone to at the garage? It was almost kind of surreal to you know, get that opportunity to wrestle in the garage, and that was that. Even though it was just a, you know, it was a pre-show and whatever, like, it was still pretty busy. There's still like all the kind of silver and gold tickets people. I think a few more people had upgraded and stuff. So that was felt like quite a landmark kind of achievement, I guess. And also, you know, just that physical, obviously the garage is just
I'd probably say
the
garage.
Yeah, that I'd say that's our two answers. But then it's weird because the Fairfield Club is great as well. Obviously in Govan it's wild, like you don't really get. It's, well, in terms of family shows, like, for just sheer venomous crowd reaction. Like, we had a guy nearly try and fucking glass Mikey before in the Fairfield Club for CPW, you know what I mean? Like, that's a different level of, you know. It's,
and he was eight.
Exactly. had a hard 8 years, you know. Honestly, they're so unintimidated, all these kids. Like, you try to be a bad guy and they just look at you like, mate, what are you gonna do? And it's like, well, actually nothing, because I don't want to get done for battering a fucking child. So yeah that's what I'd say. It's like a mix of those kind of things are obviously there.
That's why I love watching those shows, because Source ran it a little bit as well, the Fairfield, and they just don't give a fuck. They're just like, you know what, we think you look like, you're a woman, we think you look like a man, we're gonna spend the next 10 minutes chanting you're a man. And like I say, you can't do anything about it, because you can't batter a kid.
No.
You're just like,
man. Although I guess in football, it's even more difficult in Johnston, Because at least the Fairfield Club has like the tables, like kind of making barriers, whereas you go to Johnston and there's no barriers and it's just literally like, I don't know if you ever saw the reel that I put up when we wrestled there, and it was like the fucking Walking Dead. It was like a horde just overtook Mikey. We went to start a match. Stegan's Ando on the other side. I'm standing there and I'm like, where the fuck is he? And look over and I can't even see Mikey, and amongst just this swarm of children who are battering him with the fucking blow up bats and stuff. I have to go through Wade through. Get the fucking Wade. Get, come on, Mikey, you know, we've got to fucking start this match, you know. We want to get home tonight, you know. Just different, man. Like, yeah, no, that was well security. I standing about just like, oh. And I was going, it's like, get them back, man. Come on, try to have a fucking wrestling match here. Come on. Yeah, no, that's a different experience, man. It's a different world.
Oh, the smartest thing he ever did was get baseball bats, because W3L used to have the claw hammers, the inflatable hammers, and oh, kids in Elgin anyway, they wouldn't use the actual hammer end, they would turn it to the claw end and start smacking people with it. And I was watching it going, savage. This is, how is this happening? This is the one that's horrible for them involved. They're getting smacked, because I'm just watching them getting smacked with his claw, and you know, it's not sharp, but it's a lot fairer than the actual hammer side of it.
Oh, definitely.
I imagine. I haven't been hit by one, so you know, it's young. The years are young, so I'm sure once the inflatable hammer comes to this house, I'm going to get smacked with it a few times. Lily's also asked, favourite match that you've ever wrestled? So you kind of mentioned a few matches that you've had that you've enjoyed. Is there any one or two that are above the rest?
My personal favourite at the moment is the Pope.
Deadpool Danger was, yeah, it's a shame because the footage seems to have just been lost to history somehow. But
I've never ever seen the film flashback. But
I think that was the first match that we did that had like proper like storyline stakes. We had like a good amount of time. We were able to tell that purely encapsulated story. The crowd were really into it. They really bit on everything because they did genuinely believe that any of us could have lost our name at any point. And just everything went off without a hat check. Everything just went absolutely perfectly.
The reaction at the end was good.
I think that was the first, because that was that the first match we won in Gutters? I think it was. So like the crowd reaction that we got, and I think it was the first time we ever got a casino chant, which has become pretty commonplace for a lot of our matches now, but that was the first time that we'd actually, you know, really got a good, you know, that was the first time we really felt like proper baby faces as well, like overcoming the odds and all that kind of stuff and telling that story. So, Deadpool's definitely up there. Toss the match we had with L&D was really good.
Yeah.
Again, really short. Again, just like, I guess the first time we were babyface and CPW.
Another great.
Not to pat ourselves on the back too much, you know. So, another great match that we had, by the way.
Fair 6 cents. I enjoyed that as well.
Yeah, that was like just, you know, it was really good. They were really good lads. Really enjoyed working there. But that was just a kind of one shot thing, because they've not even really been back in CPW, but it was just cool to, you know.
Definitely.
I think that was the first time we'd ever had like an outside team brought in specifically to face us as well. So that was pretty cool. But even the match that we had yesterday, I think that was pretty, again, pretty landmark, pretty working, obviously, you know, guys the caliber of BT and Kez, thank you, those two exactly. Literally, you know, the guy who trained us and the other guy who now helps to, you know, coach us as well with Kez. Mm-hmm. So that was the first time we've ever been involved in like we had the KOE thing before, but that stuff yesterday, I think that was a different level of because even we did the KOE thing, people didn't really know that much who we were.
Yeah.
And ICW, whereas yesterday, like, we got a really good reaction, and it felt like we were actually doing like a full, like, kind of almost like Attitude Era type storyline or angle that, yeah, had like real stakes behind it and stuff. That was pretty banging as well. So.
Fantastic. So we've got a couple questions from Judas Gray.
So it's just, we go on for like fucking like 15 minutes again on every question, and just fantastic. We actually get through some of these fucking questions. I'll ask you your favourite match, not your favourite 10 fucking matches. Yeah.
I appreciate long answers. Like I said, I'm very, very Actually, I quite like that you're doing long answers, because if it's the two split screen that we're doing, it would be you guys answering and just me just in the corner just going.
So it's not just back and forth.
Yeah, so now it's going back. It will be going back and forth. So when you guys are answering, like I say, you're on the big telly, you're on the big screen, and it'll just be without having to look at my face in the corner, just like looking like, I'm listening.
Have you had any episodes you've done where like the person's just not really giving you anything? Like just one word answers, two word answers and stuff, just.
I've had some. I like to some episodes. I like to do an hour. That's kind of, if I hit an hour, I'm very happy that because that's just the length I do. So if you go back, it's not always the guest's fault. It's generally my fault. But if ones are like 40 minutes or that, it's generally because I've given up asking questions because I'm not getting anything from them. So it's very rare that it's happened, but there has been one or two where I've just been like, so what's your favorite Pokemon? Do you like Pokemon? I'm kidding.
Hitmonlee, nice. My favorite Pokemon, nice. Zangoose. Nobody gives my boy Zangoose the time of day.
Is that the big cat, the pink and white cat?
He's a mongoose, not a cat. Think about the name, Billy. God. This guy's in. He's on punk.
He's big cat.
That was nice. Cat put this together for me, all my stupid weeb shit, and also Solaire from Dark Souls. So, pretty.
I don't know why I mentioned Pokemon. Last time I mentioned it on a podcast, I got really annoyed because I think Rotom is the most stupidest podcast I've ever. Podcast, possibly that as well. Rotom is the stupidest Pokemon I've ever seen, and I hate it.
Really? Even more than Chimeko? The keys?
I've not seen Chimeko, so possibly it might. The ice cream one's also fairly hard.
I'm saying this just in case Jake Lawless is watching this, because that's his favourite Pokemon, and he'll be sitting there fucking raging, going, Chimeko? Chimeko? Yeah. He fucking will.
Chimeko is literally the good stuff.
You fucking handsome bastard. You fucking piercing blue eyes. Your favorite Pokemon shit. Sorry, yeah, so long answers. We probably got more questions. We'll try and be a bit more.
Okay. I know, that's fine. It's fine. Cool. We've all got work tomorrow, but it's fine. We can definitely. No, honestly, I don't mind. You go. You answer as much as you want. So Judas Gray has asked questions.
When you were talking about terrible ring names, I was thinking he's got a cracking ring name, and I was actually going to bring that up. Judas has a cool fucking name. Yeah. It looks cool. He's another big fucking handsome bastard, and he's only about fucking 17 or something as well. Raging. Anyway, sorry, Judas. Hi, Judas.
It's terrible watching these wrestlers. I'm a fat 33-year-old and I'm watching these guys, and they're like, I hate 18-year-old doing flips and all that kind of stuff and just looking handsome. And then here I am looking like, there was a picture that came out from the show, I was at Inverurie, and I look like, you know, the meme of Matt LeBlanc when he was just sitting watching Friends. I was like this. And I saw myself in the background and I was like, oh God, that's who I am now. Watching the wrestling, just looking stone faced, going, this is good, kid. Anyway,
Casino Brutale fucking raging. What was the point of you coming to this fucking show?
Oh, the Renegade.
The pack, never fucking heard of them.
Our guy's got a mullet. Someone's been here for a mullet.
That's harsh. Sorry.
I was going to say, our guy's got a mullet. Someone's here for two baldy blokes, they a mullet. Right. Judas Gray's asked three questions. Here we are until midnight. Right, so he's asked, tag teams you want to fight.
Tag teams you want to fight. How many will we go for? Because I feel like we're going to end up just listing however many times. Well, wait, so we'll exclude.
Who wants it?
You want some? I'll fucking give it.
Yes.
Got no grand. Got no bang. So we're getting to face Meat Wagon again, so that's good. I guess of teams that were not currently scheduled to wrestle, or have not wrestled before,
I want to face Reese and Rogan because they're everywhere to stand. They're also just big fucking beefy bastard boys, and they're fucking great. Let's see who else is kicking about. Even in like, because we've basically faced it. We haven't yet faced Drew Mercury and Gabriel Sol, but that might be in the future, hopefully. So I'm very much like to face them two very talented young guys who haven't had that many matches yet. But they are very good. Also very young and very handsome. So a good juxtaposition against us. I think we'll maybe look down south or whatever, who's, you know. Who are the ones with, because we talked about this before. But I guess Meat Wagon was like at the top of the list. To face Meat Wagon again. Because they're just both lovely guys and can fling us about like a wet trackie. So, yeah.
Is that looking faced everyone, haven't
we? Let's
faced everyone.
Get a quick Google up. British
well, I mean, there's a wonderful article on the SWN website, which was like top 10 tag teams to watch.
SWN, I didn't read that shit. No, to be fair, whenever they come up on Twitter, especially see if what it's a show that we've been on, and it's like even the results, I'm like, oh, it's all names. Oh my god, what's Billy saying about us now?
Oh, lost a game.
What did we lose by this time? Pinfall or submission? Oh my god.
Oh, if nobody tells me, it's pinfall. So.
let's see, British tag teams currently.
Greedy Souls.
Oh, Greedy Souls, yeah, that's a good one.
That's what I'm bringing up about.
Also, like, are we just saying anybody, or is it realistic?
I mean, Judas has asked the question, so I think realism is out of the question.
Sick. we'll frame that. There you go. That would be absolute fucking top of the list stuff. Guess there's other guys from down south that'd be fucking set, like Sunshine Machine and guys like that. Lycos Gym.
Lycos Gym.
I guess who else is big in Scotland? Who are the boys from? You probably who are some of the better
Future
Foundation of the Future. That was one of the ones that we have for every. Yeah.
Any variation
of the Foundation, variation of the Future. No, we actually maybe had said to us that he was bringing the Foundation down. And we were like sick, because we'd said to him before about a couple of teams we'd like to face, and so when it got announced, we'd come like, oh sick, getting the fight to fight, and then the first time. Termination Z versus Foundation. I'm like, all right, cool, okay, I guess we'll just go fuck ourselves. All right, cool. And then they were coming to him, like, all right, this is Govan. Govan team versus Foundation.
God damn it!
God fuck!
God!
But yeah, Foundation would definitely be up there. Obviously, we've already faced the Bear City Saints. It's pretty much all the huge. I'd feel really bad if we'd missed somebody really big in Scotland that we've not faced. Billy, can you weigh in on this? Are there any other big tag teams in Scotland that were maybe missing?
Oh, you put me on the fence. You put me on the fence now. No, you haven't. You put me on the spot.
Already faced them, so
yeah, because obviously, like, of course, what God knows how many other times we'll face KOE, Arc Advance, Young Team.
So up here, you've got the Outfit, and then who else? Got Game On down in Fair City. Got
yeah.
Got a couple teams there.
Nathan North, and somebody Mel,
Duke Cannon.
Duke Cannon, that's the one. But who are the boys at Discovery? Oh wait, fucking Kings of the North. Love to face Kings of the North. We would get fucking leathered and it'd be so much fun. Big Daddy Bonesaw, man, what a fucking lovely guy. And stupid sexy Corbin.
Bonesaw just reminds me of Jim McDonald.
Good, and then big fucking Damien Corbin will put his arm up and I'm like, I'm fucking nothing now. Jesus Christ, look at this big fucking ride, honestly.
We've not wrestled the par 2-on-2 yet.
Yeah, we'd love to wrestle the par, but we have wrestled them to a degree.
Aye.
Yes, that's good.
That's what I've not counted.
The Meat Factory, they're kind of coming up as well. We could probably have a lot of fun with them, so. God knows all the different promos that we could do for these guys as well. Yeah, be some good shit. Pretty much faced every like all the big ones, is it? Because we face, well, I guess we'd like to face Lowe and Krieger again, because we only last time we faced them, it was literally like 2.5 minutes. So it'd be nice to have maybe a longer match for them. Right, so okay, Judas had three questions, so
let's move on. Well, it doesn't get any better. So his next question is singles you want to fight. So who do you want to have?
Well, we just pick one each. Oh, is that big Judas throwing down the gauntlet? Try to get himself booked at Gardner's, are they? All right.
obviously, one of the top for me on singles is Andy Roberts. Obviously, I'd said that, but I mentioned him. Before, I suppose you can't understand. Can't you feel like you're wrestling the singles when you're wrestling the tag team? Like,
who are you
thinking
of?
It's just like when you wrestle
I guess singles wise, probably the two guys that we had yesterday in the match. I'd love to have a match with Kezo. I'd love to have a match with BT. That'd be good because years ago in the air, the Elite Rumble for Pro Wrestling Elite, I got to do some stuff with BT one-on-one, but obviously, you know, that's a whole different than a whole match. It'd be pretty, especially since however many students from Gudders and stuff have already faced them, and then we've been kind of omitted because we're obviously, you know,
a tag team.
When was the last time I even had a singles match? Xander, that was the last time I had a singles match.
Another singles match that I'm hoping happens soon that I want to have is against Brannigan.
Brannigan.
Brannigan's
actually what a guy, man.
Up.
So good, man.
I'd love to wrestle.
So Brannigan. Technically proficient.
He's brilliant.
And just so dry. He is the driest man I've ever met, and I fucking love him for it. Just what a lad.
Aye.
Absolutely.
Brannigan. We'll see you as well, Judas, son. We'll see you.
Oh, you can find yourself a tag partner. You know, we'll get this sorted.
Yeah.
Get some of those discovery bookings going.
I would like another question, please, Billy.
Okay. Judas Gray has asked. favorite to watch in CPW.
He's trying to resell over.
Oh, who could it be? Oh, no, don't.
I was on the last show.
Don't talk about how cool my look, my faith no more thing is. Oh my god, it's me. Favorite watching CPW.
Apart from us.
Well, I mean, you can only watch the other, I suppose, unless you're watching the footage back.
With CPW. I mean, it's that roster seems to grow. Because Raven, you know, will bring in people from other promotions to, you know, kind of keep things fresh and, you know, do other shows, etc. Who's the most fun to watch in CPW? Trying to think of the storylines and stuff they've got going on.
James Erdos. See his questions he brings up. I can't do them. These are meant to be for children, and I sit backstage a lot. You don't know.
It's for smart children. Yeah, no, James Erdos is
he's
good.
He's
big, great. Big
chairs.
Big chairs slash monstrum is a, you know, he's a very proficient big man. Very, very fun to watch. He's upped his promo game recently as well with the whole. Well, so that's always good. In fact, well, I guess when he's there, like Stevie James, which is actually just Stevie James as usual.
Yeah, perfect.
In terms of, in fact, singles matches, I'd love to wrestle Stevie James. Because then I can have a stupid perfect match like Stevie always has with every opponent, you know. So, honestly, if I could put you on the spot, man, he goes, "Oh, can you watch my match?" I'm like, "Aye, of course." And he comes back and he goes, "Oh, have you got any?" Like, "No, of course we don't. You had a perfect match against Stevie. Do you enjoy this? Do you enjoy holding us hostage with your perfect matches? Because it's working." Well done. He does so, doesn't he? And he's so lovely all the time.
He does.
Stupid, sexy TV. He is an outlaw.
Was James Erdos the one that had the quiz and had the anagrams?
Yes.
And everyone got at least one wrong for spine.
I can't do it. I can't answer.
Yeah, I saw the wrong answers for spine, and it did. I was like, that's amazing.
I guess also just, you know, the Govan team in general, particularly like Xander's like our boy. Like he is just, anything you do with Xander is just always gold.
Definitely.
Like especially a lot of the time, to be fair, like now, like Raby's obviously having to kind of run shows and stuff, so planning he isn't necessarily as like, you know, deep into it as, you know, especially if it's a tag match and he kind of leave it to Xander or Steg, but those two are always great to watch, great to work, always up for doing, and they're also the kind of cornerstone of CPW for a reason, so.
Suppose I like watching Judas Grey as well.
I guess he's no bad. With luscious flowing locks and his fucking fishnets and all that. Stupid, sexy bastard. How old is Judas Grey? He's about 20 or something, honestly. His fucking chiseled jaw. Fuck off, Judas. you and your questions.
Again, we're going back to bloody hell. Wrestlers nowadays are awful handsome, aren't they?
I know. Well, you called a lot of people
handsome, like. They are, man. I can't help it. There's a reason that these guys are getting, you know, their chances partially, I guess, because, you know, they're marketable and they look good. And fair play, they're also putting the time in. So it's not like Judas just looks good and then he's a wee weed or something. He's got a bit of fucking size to him as well. So fair play. Big Ronan King, man. Fucking what a unit. What a fucking guy, man. Obviously, seeing all the stuff at SWN, everyone didn't realize he was like, but he's looked like 6'2", 6'3". Big guy. Big boy.
Ah, he's
funny. He
is,
man. Big guy.
I'm just going to throw in mine, because you guys are throwing in handsome ones. Caleb. Big Caleb's my big handsome boy.
Oh, yeah. There's in fact, tag team match. Him and Aspen are tagging.
Him and Odin. Oh, are they?
Him and Odin? Who's
Odin?
I
didn't realize.
Are they doing all the stuff at Discovery? They're tagging, right?
I think so. They're kind of tagging, but not really at the same time. Yeah,
no, like I imagine if they were tagging, yeah, no, that would be, because Aspen's fucking sick as well. Where's my fucking King's Road, Granite Road style and all that shit. Yeah, fucking drop me on my head, Aspen. Do it. I fucking dare you. Not really sure that wants to get dropped on his head. Oh. Here I am stealing your thunder, man, sorry. Drop both of us on our head, Aspen. We both dare you, I guess.
Yes.
Sorry.
Mikey, I feel like you're losing the will to live a little bit. right, okay, we've got one question left in my handwriting, my scroll here. I think. Just make sure. Yeah. Stone Malone, a nice easy one to finish up the questions. He's just asked, favourite McFlurry?
Ooh, that's a good question. Also, hello, Stone. Another lovely man.
Yeah.
Also pretty handsome, to be fair. I feel like I'd feel bad if I wasn't to comment on somebody's looks then.
I know, you've been so deep in.
Yeah. I like an Oreo McFlurry, personally.
I suppose the Biscoff, when it was here.
Good shout, Michael. Very nice.
But if it was still going and it wasn't discontinued, caramel sundae.
My man.
I'm a man of simple taste. I'm a Smarties guy. Just give me some Smarties.
Yeah, man, they're all good. In fact, apart from my crunchy McFlurry, actually.
Aye.
You brought up Oreo, which is like a stale biscuit. It's
rank. Well, don't be coming for Oreos, bro. That's not a battle you're going to win. See if we put this out to everybody and go crunch your Oreo. You're going to get fucking stampeded.
I
wish they would put it in a McFlurry. A bounty.
Oh, get out fuck of here. Off. This is
love a bounty.
Fuck off.
Nom nom nom. Fucking coconut. Oh, man. It's the fucking best. There you go, killed this conversation, stone dead. Stone the lunch, stone dead. There you go, man.
Well, that seems like a good time to start wrapping up.
McFlurry. That's my new answer. If they could provide the science for such a thing.
I hate about you so much.
The worst.
They are the worst, aren't they?
Oh, I'm very good. Fucking Mr. Crunchy coming at me. Jeez.
Coconut. Coconut's great, man.
You don't like coconut?
No.
That's a shame.
But a tag team, but isn't that perfect as a tag team? It's like the olive theory. It's like one of you will eat the bounties. That's just the, if you get a celebrations thing, that's one of you will eat the bounty. So that's a teamwork.
Why?
There you go. I don't eat the outsiders on bread.
Why?
You do. Because I'm leaving them for you, I guess.
I'm a money saver. Money saving.
throwing away.
Somebody's got to eat the outsiders.
Do you eat the outsiders on bread, Billy?
Aye. Well, yeah. up here we call them heels.
To be fair, it's not like I really dislike them. I just personally don't.
Aye, I'm not going my way.
Like, if I was starving and there was only two of the heels or two outsiders left, like, I'd absolutely make a sandwich with it. But normally it's not my go-to.
I wouldn't make a sandwich with it. No, that's to be toast or cheese on toast or something. That's what you use them for. You didn't make a sandwich with them. That's weird.
Would you eat just a normal outsider without toasted? Or?
I'll bet you a rogue. I would just put about a couple of bits of cold meat and cheese and they just fold it.
Nice.
Do even to land a sandwich, just one slice of bread.
The half sandwich?
Aye.
Oh, yeah. the thrifty man's friend. There you go.
So before we wrap up, I want to speak about your merch. I want to speak about your merch, because the bounty chat's
just
a little bit. And plus, weirdly enough, because of the hour, clearly I'm staying up too late because my dog's come down to look at me going, "Hey, you, come on, bedtime, prick." So talk about merch. So you've teamed up with ICW Fans Podcast and they're doing like kits, like gambling kits. Was that something that they just approached you with, or was that something that you thought about before?
No, they
approached us. They were very... They had everything, like they planned everything, they'd done everything. They were absolutely amazing to see throughout the whole process.
So good.
Of the competition. They were so good. It was all them. We can't take any credit for anything.
No, it was all fully fully realised and stuff. They already had the decks, they had the chips and everything. They just obviously put their heart and soul into that. Fair play to them, So great, great bunch of guys and lasses.
But, I mean, perhaps you don't get anything, but maybe if you win the famed poll, you might get a little trophy next year. You know, everyone loves a competition poll that are absolutely not rigged. That people can win.
Man, if we could get booked on the East Coast more, we would. You know, we'd be shitting up those fucking rankings. But you know, to be fair though, the majority of your viewership is from... I'm assuming the majority of your viewers are from that side of the country.
I assume, like, so.
It's gonna go that way. I don't think you're having, you know, fucking wait and vote. So
I'll show the casino bastards.
Yeah, take them down a peg.
Girders won one to watch for the promotion, so clearly there is a little bit of an audience there. You possibly were in the top three for tag team to watch as well. So
Girders is fucking class, so I can't really argue with that. I guess that's probably just because have there been any new promotions that have come up on the East Coast recently?
Not on the East Coast, no. There's been our promotions on the other side. <now. laughs>
Take that. Non-production.
Take you all your guys and awards for doing your good wrestling on the other side of the country. How dare you?
How dare you? You've been good.
Yeah. Also, foundation, if you happen to have any bookings coming up or any, you know, space for a tag team. Just want to wrestle the foundation of the future, man. Such nice guys. So good. So beefy. Yeah, man. What's his chops? Big Brad, man. Fucking the weights that he throws about, man. Wild. 200 kilo squats and all this. I feel tired just watching it. He said all his workout stuff that he puts up, Billy. He's a fucking, he's an absolute unit. What a guy.
Of course, I see everything. I see everything. In the yeah,
I have Billy.
Even the stuff I don't want to see, I see. So that's I think this is probably a good time to wrap up then. I think we've exhausted the questions that we got, thankfully, from people. I think we get into Rabu's amazing body transformation, which clearly you're building up the muscles, so when BT gun chops you, it's not going to hurt as much.
Oh man, I didn't even get chopped yesterday and I was raging. Honestly, what's even the point? Hey, man. Do you want to get chopped by BT though? I just want to see how it feels in terms of, well, obviously it sounds fucking ridiculously good, but how much does it hurt in comparison? What's the ratio? I want to put it on a graph. You know what I mean? I want to break this shit down. You're totally fucking done, aren't you?
I know, I can see it. I can see it in his face.
James Eldos's next worksheet will have a graph on it and he'll be absolutely knackered.
Okay, we're definitely going to finish up now. So thank you very much for taking time to speak to us. I've got someone else in the room on the dog. So plug your shit. Plug whatever. Your social medias, your merchandise, plug everything.
So we have a new t-shirt that's just coming out. Michael, if you want to stand up and model it, it's the Play to Kill cream variant of the Casino Brutale t-shirt. Our first batch sold out pretty quickly, so we've got a new shipment in, which will be on sale on all the, so you can get them online as well. But you can get them any of the shows that we're going to be on. We've got quite a busy the rest of September. Like I said, we've got CPW, Big Match for Meat Wagon, Comic Con, that's going to be fucking sick, 2 full days. God knows how many matches we'll have on that. Ruggie Slam, so that's a whole new audience and stuff there as well. I think we've got more stuff coming up in October and stuff for CPW as well. There's more Girder shows coming up the 28th of October. And do we have any other stuff to plug? No. You want to plug your 8x10s?
No, I don't know there.
We also have 8x10s, which Mikey bought.
8x10s are the Wee by Wees. I don't know.
Sorry, Wee by Wees. And they're also on the sale at Shows Bank. We've sold. How many?
We've sold one.
We've sold one. Somehow, some way, people don't actually want Wee by Wees of two bald guys. But there you go, honestly.
The one sale was me.
Yes, you're a very good... I know I've said it a lot. You're a good-looking man.
The there one who is a me.
Yeah, exactly. It's just piercing blue eyes. Do we have anything else to plug, or is that... Yeah.
Like... I would say my social media is Billy, but I don't know them.
He's Mikey Devine 1, and I'm Rabu Romero.
There might be extra E's and Y's.
You definitely make you Devine 1 on Twitter or X or whatever it's called now. In fact, that you're still Michael. No, it comes up just you'll probably see God knows what other promos and stuff. We're not a team that's shy on promotion as it is, so you know, maybe not necessarily need to super plug things. It's mainly the t-shirts. The t-shirts are doing well.
Yeah.
The brave choice to not just do a black t-shirt as well was quite controversial, it seems to be working out quite well. So,
bold strategy,
man. See how it works out for us.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me. Like I said, this is a weird episode where everyone's full screen at some point in the episode. So this is me who's being full screen at the moment, I think, because I'm speaking. But
hi.
This has been a...
Hello.
Hi,
Billy.
We're
on the screen now.
I feel like I'm glad I told you this now and not really at the start. But that's how it was going to work. But this has been a chaotic episode with Casino Brutale. Thanks again.
Thanks for your time.
Bye bye. Yahoo!